To switch off your mobile phones and also remind members to declare any relevant financial or other interest in relation to today's business. Apologies, I have apologies from Danny Kennedy, Robin Newton and Nelson Cosland. Anybody else aware of and Pat? Ava and Pat? So the only person there's a question mark over will be whether Jonathan shows up at some stage. Okay, Chair's business, GCSE and A-level results. Members, yesterday the statistics were produced on year 14 and year 12, so the A-level and GCSE results for 2014-15. I think it was pretty good news overall, and particularly was improvement in the free school meal entitlement pupils, five good GCSEs, including English and Maths results. And they've moved up from 38.7% to 45.6%, which is a pretty large leap. Now, there was a small reduction in A-level results for SMA for the free school meals entitlement pupils, and the impact of these results on the PFG schools leaver target is not yet clear, but I think certainly something I think we would welcome. Isn't that right? Second issue, just to bring to people's attention, Woodlands, we got in the table papers correspondence from an individual raising issues in respect of employment concerns on Woodlands in Bangor. Obviously, as a committee, we don't get involved in individual employment or other cases. However, there is a wider issue, which is the issue around reported transfer of responsibility of Woodlands from DOJ to DE. Maybe we just get a bit of clarification from the department if members are happy enough with that. Okay. Right, draft minutes. They're page 6. Members content that they're a true and accurate record of the minutes? If so, I'll sign those. Matters arising. At page 16, the clerk cover note in relation to the future of the Youth Council. There's a written statement from the future of the Youth Council at page 19, and the summary report of the responses to the consultation is also appended in table papers now. I'll just seek the members' views on the Minister's decision to transfer funding responsibilities for regional youth, vulnerable youth organisations to the EA from the 1st of April. It's also, I suppose, your views on Minister's indication that he wants to wind up the Youth Council before September 2016 and establish a partnership chaired by DE involving other education and other key stakeholders. So, put open to members. Chris is first.
It may not come as any great surprise, but I think the Minister is doing the right thing. As long as we can maybe, I don't know if, is the Department or the Minister coming to brief us on this decision, or can we maybe ask for this to have a discussion with the Minister on this? Maybe there's some assurances we'd like to seek. All right, like we know, for example.
Yeah, certainly, I don't think there's been an offer, but certainly we can ask the Minister.
I think the Minister did indicate that he could meet with the Chair to discuss it informally with yourself, I believe, in his letter.
I think, to be fair, I would prefer, in light of circumstances, that if there's going to be, that indeed the Minister comes before the committee rather than just...
Or even, did you, in the new year, about budget or anything like that? Or?
Officials are, but the Minister was.
Oh, okay.
I think, to be fair on that, I suspect to officials will say, this is a decision taken by the Minister, really we can't comment on policy type of thing on it, so I suspect...
The thing I was going to say about assurance really is, that I think in light of the sort of economic times especially, we know the value of a pound that came from Youth Council was able to leverage money, and there's some worry there that from Youth Services and the EA it may not be able to do this. Certainly whatever partnership they're going to design in the future would be important, I think, that they get the value for their pound.
I understand that, Chris. I mean, I think the concern would be on a number of fronts, to be honest on it. I mean, there's concern from the organisations themselves, and to some extent if we're looking at the financial aspect, if all the money is going to transfer and be ring fenced as regards the voluntary organisations, which represent about 81% of the budget, and all the staff are getting offered the opportunity to simply transfer in and their jobs will be protected in that regard, A, you've got to kind of wonder what the savings are, and also given that I think on the consultation that pretty much there was nobody called for the abolition of the Youth Council, it does seem to go against that. Now, I appreciate the point you've made in relation to that, but another folk also in Brendan, Sean?
Yeah, I think you know, the idea of getting the Minister here just would be certainly a good idea, because really, I have to say, the last time with the officials, I thought their explanations were very inadequate. You know, like I asked about, we talked about, you know, this 800,000 that transpired was 332,000. Have we had any feedback from the department on that breakdown of that? And that was one of the things I specifically asked for. Just really very unhappy thing. But I think if we could get the minister to come to an education committee, it would be helpful, because there's a lot of questions that haven't been answered in any way.
Sandra?
Yes, I was very disappointed with the minister's decision and felt that, you know, the way that he went about it obviously wasn't good. Whenever it needs to be questioned why he didn't review the youth council as such, similar to other ministers reviewing the likes of the Consumer Council. You know, it should have been, it would have been preferable to have been carried out in that way. But I think it's, as other members have said, it would be good to hear from the minister himself and committee.
Trevor, finally.
Yeah, well, I really do wonder what's the value of a consultation. You know, if every response is positive in terms of retaining the youth council, the committee was actually unanimous. Chris, I'm sorry, but I don't think you were here, and may have did speak in favour. And yet the minister continues on this road, which that doesn't appear to make any sense to anybody else. So by all means, let's get him here. But what worries me is that, I mean, he says he's going to introduce primary legislation to dissolve the Youth Council. I doubt if he'd get that through the House. But at the same time, he probably is able to withdraw the funding and channel it through the New Education Authority if he wants to. And so we're not in a good position here. But trying to change his mind, I think.
There are still clearly some, as a minimum, I think it's fair to say, concerns that need addressed and probably levels of opposition on it, but resolved, I suppose, really to seek the minister to come before the committee on the issue, I think.
Sure.
Go ahead.
Perhaps, you know, the minister's offered an informal meeting yourself. Perhaps we could say an informal meeting, just spread it out to the committee then.
The only complication that, Chris, is that there's a lot of organisations. I mean, it strikes me that I certainly got a lot of feedback, as I was as chair, from a range of organisations after we'd done the session. I think other members probably did as well. I think that side complication I would say a little bit is that I think people will want to hear what the rationale, if for instance that for the sake of argument, if the minister is able to provide some level of assurance that satisfies people, to be honest, it's not a question ultimately of satisfying me or satisfying even members around this table. It's actually ultimately about satisfying the organisation. So I think it's one of those things, to be honest, I would prefer to have a session with the minister who's in front of the committee, and it's in public session in that regard, so that organisations can hear what's being said. Because they're really the people who are affected at the end of the day. Those of us around this table, we have an interest in it, but we don't. It's not a direct impact in the sense of these organisations saying, what help they're going to have with governance, what their level of funding is, what level of protection is going to be there for the future, and that's it. Okay, right. Move on then to the next item, which is the Shared Education Bill. Now, we've already done the closed session, I think, which was very helpful with Ailish, so we'll move into the public session. Members, so welcome our representatives from the department. There's a cover note of page 51 in the papers. There's an updated clause-by-clause table at page 52. Hard copies of the Shared Education Bill, explanatory memorandum, the financial memorandum are available to members. Hard copy of the list of bills, Bill Office amendments provided, and a letter to the department's amendments tabled. Also in tabled items is a response from the department in relation to the issue of religious beliefs of school pupils. We're now going to formally determine and set out the committee position on each of the proposed amendments to each clause, and we'll divide as necessary. All decisions of the committee in that sense will be final. That doesn't, of course, mean that whenever we come to the floor of the chamber, members aren't free to take whatever views they or put forward whatever amendments they want to put forward. And I'd also remind members that there's the opportunity that if the committee is not content with a particular clause, and I don't think there's really been, to be fair, any particular suggestion of this case, the committee can register its formal opposition to the clause, stand part of the bill, and that would have to be debated at consideration stage. And it's anticipated the committee will conclude all formal deliberations of today's meeting, and the committee will then agree its report arising out of today's meeting on the 6th of January 2016. And I'd like to welcome, so somewhat belatedly therefore, the following departmental officials are here to answer any questions. We have Andrew Bell, who's the head of Shared Education and Community Relations team. Suzanne Kingan, who is the head of Irish Medium and the Integrated Education team. Joanne Maxwell, who's the Shared Education and Community Relations team. And Jackie Durkin, who's the Director of Area Planning. Obviously, we've got the number of the amendments we're going through. We'll go through those individually. Is there anything you want to say just at this stage, initially? Or?
Well, most of the points that we wish to make were made at last week's informal deliberation. However, it might be helpful just to say a few points at this stage in some of the key areas that members will consider this morning. In relation to the definition of Clause 1, the definition, as you know, sets out the minimum essential requirements for shared education, those of religious belief and socio-economic background. Mm-hmm. And as previously indicated, ironically, referencing all the Section 75 categories in the legislative definition risks exclusion rather than inclusion. Religious belief has been used in the bill as terminology.
Just interrupt you a little bit on that, but if there's any points you want to make that over and above what is being dealt with directly in the amendments, because rather than get into some of those bits on it, we can deal with each of those and we'll give you certainly on each of those occasions there'll be opportunity for yourselves to make comment on the individual ones, and that might be a more helpful way.
That's okay. That's
if there's
fine.
Anything
that's
outside of the amendments really that you wish to...
No, it's mostly thanks. Mind amendments.
Right, I'll just direct first of all the members to page 52, which starts off with clause 1, which is providing a common definition of shared education. Now, I think across this, by the way, we've got 6 or 7 amendments that we need to look at. I think there's 7 if you include the one from the department. I'll direct first of all to members to amendment 1, which, if it was made, would leave out religious belief and insert community background. So just ask maybe the department if you have anything comments just to make in relation to that.
Religious belief is consistent with the policy and it reflects the wording of the relevant Section 75 category. That's why we used it. Community background is not routinely collected. To do so would impose further administrative burden on education providers. The Quality Commission guidance and Section 75 monitoring guidance indicates that there are 2 options for monitoring religious belief, that of current stated religion or community background, and what we're proposing is current stated religion. And the guidance then goes on to say that for the purposes of Section 75, the current stated religion question is more appropriate as it better recognises the increasing diversity of society here. In contrast, the statistics of the department collect, we have 31 separate categories which include no religion. So that's why we believe that religious belief is
and would, just to clarify then, so you collect the present of schools on the basis of 31 categories of, put under the broad umbrella of religion. One of those categories is effectively no religious belief or none in that regard. The other 30 is a sort of, whenever I say effectively subcategorised, you have presumably
the different denominations.
And then also then different religions, be it sort of Islam or Buddhism or whatever, those would
indeed, you've no religion. You've also got other Christian, if it doesn't fit into one of the other categories, other Protestant and unclassified, so it does cover the full range.
Okay. Open up the doors, Trevor.
Is humanism in there?
No.
Not advocating, I just wondered.
Well, that would be...
The
humanists would argue strongly that they are a religion because they don't have any. Which is, when you say no religion is one of them.
Well, I'm not sure whether we do that as no religion or unclassified. I'm not quite sure how the schools would record that.
Chris?
Just wondering to what extent the effect of adding or none after religious belief would have.
Well, one of the things which we are looking at, because religious belief, we are considering whether we need to put something into the bill just to make it clear that religious belief at the moment would not include no religion. So we are looking to see whether it would be helpful to actually put that into the bill, and if so, that would be at consideration stage that we would.
Yes, I mean,
at the moment, maybe
this is overly simplistic. The point's been made by Chris and others, and I think Trevor beforehand as well. If you add the words or none, that not if you're talking about religious belief or none, does that not clarify that?
Well, the advice is that we're better taking the lines as used in the Fair Employment Commission, so that if we can use the word none within the terminology, so there would
be a
clause.
Phraseology about are those of
essentially what would happen is there would be a clause that would go in to say religious belief as defined in the bill would include those of a religion and those of none, those of no religion is what it would actually say, as opposed to.
Just to make the point, a lot of the people who don't have a religion would almost be quite offended at being categorised as having a religion because they had none. You know, I hear this argument, it doesn't make any sense to me.
Well, that would follow that follows the guidance of the Equality Commission.
Okay, Sean?
But going to the Equality Commission, is it, and the Fair Employment, is it, I find a significant difference between the term religious belief and different religious beliefs. Because to me, different religious belief assumes you have a religious belief. You know, so if you were just, I would agree with you in terms of your talking religious belief, you could include none there. The word different there, I think.
I think it's important to keep sight of the fact that this is the minimum requirement, and that's very much where we're coming from in the bill, you know, the bringing together those of different religious belief, including the reasonable numbers of Roman Catholics and Protestants. That's a minimum requirement for shared education. I think it's important to keep sight of that when we're looking at it. It's not, you know, as we've explained before in terms of the policy is very much directed towards bringing all Section 75 groups together, increasing awareness of all Section 75 groups. But this is the minimum requirements, and really there's a focus in there on bringing together children from the two main communities here because of the stark difficulties in the situation here, and I think it's just to keep in mind it is a minimum requirement. You know, it's not the pinnacle, it's not defining, you know, what all shared education activity will be about.
Trevor?
I don't want to trivialise this at all now, but you know, saying that somebody who has no religion actually has a religion, but has no religion, let me put it this way. If you're categorising non-smokers as smokers who don't smoke, I would say that's about the same thing. It doesn't need us.
What they actually ask for is there's a section on the form which says religion, and you can actually write in against it no religion. You know, so at that point, that's what they would do.
No religion is an explicit category. It's listed there, and you can designate as no religion.
What stage, I mean, Andrew, you mentioned that, and I appreciate. This is obviously we're in a certain level of time difficulties. You indicated that the department was looking to bring forward an amendment to essentially cover that point.
We're considering whether it's necessary to do that because, you know, just for clarity.
I maybe picked you up wrong. So what you're saying is you may or may not put down an amendment to cover this point. But obviously, A, we don't know what the wording is at present of that, and even if you're going to do it or not.
Yeah, I mean, if we were proposing to do it, certainly, if we were proposing to do it before consideration states, obviously we would try to let you see that ahead of it. But it is really as to whether we need to have that clarity within the bill or not. So we're still getting advice on that.
Okay, there seem to be a couple of things. I mean, it strikes me that slightly as regards Amendment 1, the ground has slightly shifted here. I'm detecting, and if anybody correct me if I'm wrong, there's obviously an issue around how the categorisation of those who don't have religious beliefs are categorised. Specifically, I've not heard anybody particularly argue that community background should replace religious beliefs, if I'm right on that side of it.
Yeah, I wonder, should it just be different religions and take out the belief? Do you know, because you're saying religion or no religion, do you know, so, and, or if you want to refer, I don't know, maybe you don't want to refer within the bill, pair the collected data, so that if You change.
The data would probably change the way, you know, there is a potential in the future that the data collection and the fields could change. So I don't think we would want to particularly refer to.
The reason we used religious belief was because that's the Section 75 category, and as you know, the policy then goes on to encourage other Section 75 categories. So it was to be consistent with the Section 75 categories, that's why we've used it rather than anything else. But given that the Equality Commission guidance actually says that you can use current stated religion, which essentially is what we are collecting, whatever the current stated religion is, the guidance says that, that is acceptable for religious belief.
Okay. It seems to me there's a couple of different options for us here from detecting where. Is a bit, you know, either the committee could put forward its own amendment, although we'd need to agree some form of wording, and then depending upon what the department did, either move that or not move that. Second option is if the department is considering this, that we hold back in putting forward an amendment, but if we're not satisfied with their members can put forward their own amendment. I'd be happy to be guided by the committee just in terms of what they want to do. If there's a specific amendment, people would, I think, need to put forward some sort of form of specific wording for the committee.
I was still on Amendment 1.
Yeah.
I think it's been a wee bit discredited, hasn't it?
No, the point I'm making was, if we're dealing with the issue about religious belief, it's clear that purely as regards Amendment 1 that was drafted, nobody, I think, wants to push that particular bit of a community background. The point I'm making on the issue of covering the situation of people with no religious beliefs, the choices for the committee probably are twofold. Either we provide our own amendment and either move or not move that, depending upon what the committee does. If we are providing our own amendment, then we need some form of wording, a suggested wording of somebody. The second alternative is, if a department is considering an amendment, we can wait and see what amendment that is and either support it, or if it's not moved, then there's the opportunity for members to put forward their own amendment.
The only amendment we would be considering is to whether we need to put in something which makes it clear that by religious belief we include those with religious belief.
I understand that, and I think, to be fair, I think that's where the crux of the argument is, rather than, as I said, I think it's dead in the ground in terms of the community, for the reasons that have been stated. The community background stuff, I don't think anybody is particularly pursuing in that regard. So, Chris, did you want to say something?
No, it was just on the second point about the Protestant and Roman Catholic. Really, if you want to take the decision first on that first part.
Well, the problem is, at the moment, I mean, unless anybody has a specific amendment at this stage, you know, we may be in the situation of having to wait and see what the department brings forward.
Yes.
And then considering if anybody does, but unless anybody has a very specific amendment on that point. Okay, on that. John, did.
I still think we'll wait and see what the department has to say, but I think we should be putting in different religious beliefs or none.
Person, if the committee thinks that, you could put down an amendment.
It's the same symbol, you know.
Yeah, I mean, we could. I mean, one option would be if we put different religious beliefs or none as an amendment at this stage on it. If a department came up with arguable, we could certainly do better wording or something. Yeah. Sure. We could agree not to move the.
Yeah.
And we could revisit it. Okay, members.
Would it be better, to just define that, would it be better to say those of different religious beliefs, including none?
I'll ask the Bill Office Chairperson to come up with the exact wording, but I think the spirit of the amendment is evident here, or sort of that. That was not intentional at all, but I think I've got the idea of what you want. So it's either going to be or none, or of different religious belief, or a similar phrasing. So the exact phrasing, absolutely.
Appreciate from that point of view. Can we sign off then the final wording on the 6th?
Yes, because it'll be in the report. Yes.
Yes. Okay.
Yes, indeed.
Okay. Right, Chris, you had a separate point then in relation to
around we actually mentioned Protestant and Roman Catholic. Is it possible to do this without mentioning this? I have a worry that long-term unintended consequences are we keep entrenching Catholic and Protestant. Is it possible to do this without actually mentioning Protestant and Catholic, but talk about those of different religious beliefs or none?
Well, it is obviously possible to do it, but the minister's decision has been that the phrase, including reasonable numbers of Protestant and Catholic children and young people, should be included. So, obviously, from the department's perspective, any amendment would have to be agreed by the minister. Mm-hmm. In terms of the rationale, I think some of the things have been rehearsed before. Is it makes it much more explicit that you know, cooperation between different school types and sectors, which can't really be referenced in the legislation because sector's not a legislative term. It does make that much more explicit, the use of that phrase. It just, it reflects, you know, the community here and the historic differences. So for those reasons, I think, you know, the minister's decision is that it's important that this phrase is in there.
It was also to address, make sure it was clear that we were addressing a legacy of the past. It was one of the things that came up during the public consultation. There was a lot of concern that without specifically referencing, then some education providers may decide it's too difficult or too sensitive an issue to address. And that was not, it was clearly not what the intention was.
Trevor?
And is it possible to consider saying Protestant, Roman Catholic, or other children?
Well,
it's a matter of it's
possible that the because it's religious belief, the wording is religious belief, including reasonable numbers of Protestant and Catholic children, young people. So, you know, that others are already included within the religious belief definition, because it's just expanding that.
The Catholic it's setting a minimum bar again. That's where we go back to that. It's saying this has to be at its very core about bringing children from the two main community backgrounds together, and it establishes that as a minimum requirement. And, you know, in terms of the policy, again, as I said, bringing all the groups together, including others, but it just sets it there as a minimum. Shared education must do this to be shared education. And if anything else goes into that clause, it does kind of dilute that as the minimum line of this must include this.
Another day. Okay. Right, I'll move on. Before we get to Amendment 2, one other issue which has come up with us a number of times, and I think the committee feels the best way will be to seek assurance on this, is reference in terms of the interpretation of reasonable numbers provisions. And we've already had those informally discussions of the department. I suppose the concern would be that if you have sharing programmes at small rural or indeed other schools, can we get an assurance from the minister at consideration stage that there'll be a, in respect of the interpretation on the judgment of that on the shared education, but that this will not be something to be potentially used to preclude because you don't have particularly overall large numbers in that regard?
I mean, we made the minister, obviously the committee wrote to the department, we made the minister aware, so he is aware that the committee will seek that assurance at consideration stage.
I mean, either in terms of his opening remarks or alternatively there'll be an intervention from himself or somebody from the committee to seek that, so it's on the record. I think
he's aware that is something which the committee are looking for. So.
Okay. Move on then to the next potential amendment, which is the reference to integrated education and the definition of shared education. And just
one of the main reasons that the department wouldn't support this amendment is because shared education is much wider than just schools. And if you think about it, you know, a progression towards integrated education is really only suitable for two schools cooperating. Obviously, we're looking to engage early years providers, youth providers. So in terms of integrated, that doesn't really fit. I think we referenced as well the last day that the only legal definition of integrated education is the definition set out in the 1989 Education Reform Order. Mm-hmm. In that sense, it's a distinct concept defined in law. There isn't a natural progression in the sense of a legal progression from shared to integrated education. A transformation to integrated status or the opening of a new integrated school requires a statutory development proposal. And, you know, if two schools got to the stage where they felt they wanted to close and become an integrated, you know, a single integrated school, they have to go through the statutory development proposal process. There's no natural progression there. The other thing is that for a large number of schools, they won't see shared education as a progression to integrated education, and indeed the idea that it's referenced in the bill may be off-putting for some schools to participate in shared education.
Okay, any comments of members? Trevor?
Just to make the point, it wasn't me that suggested this. That may surprise you, but it wasn't. And I would have reservations about it, because number one, because the Assembly wouldn't accept it anyway. But number two, because I think we've probably come up with something better than that, frankly.
Well, is there anybody particularly to push the amendment to, or are they satisfied with?
No, and I think you know, in Suzanne, in your explanation, you went straight into the integrated education. Mm. You know, we're not necessarily talking about that. We're talking about children being educated together.
I appreciate that, but I think the difference is the legal definition is such that the legal definition is wrapped around the 1989 order, and I appreciate, I think we talked about the last day, the difference between integrated with a capital I and integrated with a small I, and I appreciate spirit, but the legal definition is around a grant-maintained and a controlled integrated school and the meaning of that in law.
I know as well we've got legal advice, which is basically saying that, shall we say, the law is sort of capital blind when it comes to big eyes, small eyes. Yeah. I suppose, strictly speaking, big E's.
There's only one definition of integrated in law, and that is the definition in the 89 order.
Okay. If we move on then to Amendment 3, which is making explicit references to further education colleges as relevant providers, and it's obviously been, we have legal drafting there for, which was added in further education as defined in Article 3 of the Further Education Order 1997. And comment.
Yeah, I mean, again, we point out that the bill as currently drafted provides for the appropriate inclusion of further education colleges within shared education projects. I suppose our concern in relation to this amendment is that this would potentially leave the department and its arm's length bodies with a power to facilitate and encourage, but without the relevant ancillary means to do so, as we don't have responsibilities for further education colleges.
Understand that, I mean, but outside of that, would you feel that it's not be any harm at all, or
really? Well, it's already included. It would.
I mean, it's maybe the argument is it's making something explicit, which is arguably implicit, but
it is, and it's also given the prominence to further education colleges over any other providers that are covered by 1(3)C. I think it is.
Although I think we do make specific references to youth services, don't we?
But I think we referenced the last day that, you know, a school solely partnering with a further education college is highly unlikely to be able to provide the range and scope of shared education experience that we would be looking to provide in terms of, well, currently the signature project, and in terms of future projects. You know, it would be very difficult to extend cooperation throughout the whole school community. It would be extremely difficult to, you know, offer a really broaden out the range of curricular cooperation as well, operating. So I think the point that Andrew was making, it gives perhaps an undue prominence to the role of further education colleges.
I was wondering, Suzanne, as part of that, maybe in devil's advocate in this, but is the exclusion mechanism on that not that potentially, if you like, the quality of the application, the quality of the project doesn't make it? Is that not, to a certain extent, reasonably self-regulating without any particular need to exclude it on that basis? I mean, I could think where they kind of shared education. I know, for instance, having gone, I think, to be fair, it was sixth form rather than further education college. I was at a prize day yesterday where there's been very strong working between a sixth form of a secondary school and some of the local primary schools, for instance, and in a sort of shared project on that basis. And I could see, and a lot of that is to do with a degree of mentoring and teaching of the younger children by way of a sort of a peer intervention in that regard. There might be something that, I mean, that potentially could be done, I could see, between a further education college and some of the schools of that nature that would be the case. But any members have any comments, just, or?
Yeah.
Sean, sorry, go ahead. Yeah.
No, I agree with it, with the chair. But and I think also, you know, if we're not going to draw, you know, then really in the next line, including youth services, should we not be leaving that out? Should we not be leaving that bit in brackets out completely? Because if you're drawing attention to youth services, then why are we not drawing attention to further education? Because I would agree with the chair. It certainly could contribute to a school's shared education, what's actually happening on the ground, because many young people at 14 go to day release and so on in the further education colleges. The early learning partnerships, there's some good work going on there as well. So my point really is, should we not be leaving out including youth services in the next line?
Youth services mentioned because there's a specific role in relation to obviously informal education the department has responsibility for, but In relation to further education colleges, I mean, the majority of work that would happen with a further education college would be through the entitlement framework. So it would be a post-primary. It would not include the whole of the post-primary. It would be a key stage three and above. And given that shared education covers youth and early years as well as schools, we don't envisage that there would be an opportunity, for example, for a youth group in a further education college potentially to participate. If there was opportunities like that, certainly the bill would not exclude it, but actually mentioning them, I suppose, brings prominence to them.
The important point for us is that further education colleges are in no way excluded, as the bill is currently drafted, from participation in shared education. Our view would be they do have a role. We do not see a particularly significant role for further education colleges in the same way the youth providers through the PEACE 4 programme. We envisage we will see significant amounts of cooperation between youth providers providing shared education projects solely by youth providers working together. We don't envisage that for further education colleges, and we feel a very specific reference to it in the bill does give it an undue prominence.
Okay,
Trevor.
Yeah, I'm just wondering, the definition of children and young persons, if you brought on further education colleges, you'd be bringing in adult education as well. So what's a child or a young person?
Well, they're defined in, I think it's the 1989 order that defines what child or children means and what a young person means.
Can you, off the top of your head?
Does it go by age? Yeah, I think it does. I think 24 for a young person, but we could come back to you on the legal definition.
24, maybe. Yeah. Specifically, then on committee on clause. Oh, sorry, on amendment 3, members want to go ahead with the amendment, or will be guided. Personally, I think it's a reasonable enough argument to go ahead with it. But does anybody take a different view in relation to that, or?
Well, I would be inclined to go with the department for once. Yeah.
Would you maybe just put it to a vote then, just in relation to it? So, those in favour of Amendment 3? Is this me? Okay, against?
1, 2.
Okay, and then you abstaining?
Abstentions.
Okay, abstentions. So then we don't move ahead with Amendment 3. Move on then to Amendment 4. Which is, I suppose, the issue is whether it's a duty or a power. I know it's been one that's been reasonably well discussed, and I suppose the issue as well is that probably the issue of promotion to make it sort of on a parallel with the Education Authority. Again, I appreciate we've had a reasonable amount of discussion. This already. Anything else you want to add just on that? This is obviously very specifically as regards the department.
Yeah, well, the discussion last week, I suppose, brought out all the key points. It's the sheer number of settings that are covered. It's the potential magnitude of impact on educational budgets and educational priorities simply because of the sheer number of settings that are covered. By contrast, then, a power provides statutory recognition of the importance of the concept of shared education within our system, but allows the department to, in conjunction with the executive...
Andrew, in terms of the impact on budgets, there's two issues in relation to that. I mean, first of all, I know it goes wider than purely shared education, but we're going to have, between shared education, I suppose, general funding probably for the integrated, and also shared housing, there'll be £500 million that's going to be made available over a 10-year period separately. And the argument that essentially, if you have a duty, this will effectively tie the hands from a budgetary point of view. I mean, presumably there are particular requirements there for integrated in Irish medium. That presumably hasn't so skewered the department's funding that it's made it difficult to fund other aspects of education.
But you're not comparing like with like. The integrated in Irish medium sector in total, we have 62 integrated schools, we have 30 Irish medium schools. We're talking well below 10% of the total school estate.
Yeah,
and I think last week we had explained it's not just in terms of the budget, in terms of actual spend on shared education projects, but if you think about how the department manages its range of policies. I think we talked about last week about the transport policy and a reasonable adjustment to transport policy or a reasonable adjustment to temporary variation policy. And it'd be very difficult to make reasonable adjustments for something that
I'm not sure that all flows from simply having a duty on the power. This particular bit. I mean, there's a duty on the Education Authority. Is it going to be?
Well, the Education Authority isn't responsible for the overall policy framework with which education operates.
I understand that, but presumably it will have to make a range of spending decisions on that basis. On it, the fact that there's a duty on this thing, I don't see that particularly securing that. But anyway, I mean, we've reasonably rehearsed the argument. Again, members have any thoughts on this, whatever?
Might just be worth pointing out the 500 million you referred to as capital. That's specifically for.
I understand that, but it's still from a financial point of view, it's still of significance in that regard. I mean, all departments' expenditure will be a mixture of resource and capital.
Majority of shared education activity is non-capital. You know, it doesn't involve capital. It involves schools cooperating to deliver the curriculum. It is not explicitly about, you know, capital investment.
Yeah, but with respect on it, this doesn't. Whether whatever is put in here doesn't actually make reference to it being sort of capital or resource.
No, but the duty will apply across the implications for that.
I'm sorry, I missed last week, Sam, because maybe I'm a bit confused here. But we're going to suggesting putting in a new clause 1A, and emphasising its duty, but the power is under section or clause 2.
I think maybe the clerk can clarify.
Yeah, Chair, what would happen then is that we would take the department out of Clause 2. It's just over the
I think the position on Trevor, where the argument essentially was, we had a number of groups that essentially made the point about power and duty. And to be fair, there seemed to be a distinction between the lobbying that we got in terms of a number of organisations. Nobody seemed particularly keen on making a duty on the arm's length bodies. So it was TCMS or if NICE were included or whoever. There's a feeling that it would be a step too far to impose any duty on them. However, a number of same organisations were saying that were also saying they wanted a duty on the department. This is where they were drawing the distinction between the two on it. So that's why I think it's separated out potentially.
But. Well, in that case, the wording of suggested 1A is factually correct, isn't it? That's already in legislation. It might irritate people like me, but it's a fact, it's there. So there's only question as well you want to put it in this bill or not to emphasise it.
I think the department would probably contend that it isn't.
Are you referring to the Education Authority? Is that there's a duty on the Education Authority?
Duty on the Education Authority, I suppose. The argument about this is whether this is actually the department, and whether they should then be mirroring what's there for the Education Authority.
Is this then imposing a new duty on the department?
It's changing the bill
from a power for the department to a duty to the department. Chris?
Just a point of clarity. Does all duties in the department not also transfer to all arm's length bodies also?
They do effectively. That would be our interpretation of our statutory duties in terms of Irish Medium and Integrated, that in effect, through us, I mean, we would put in a requirement for all our arm's length bodies to support us in.
So does that mean then, on that basis, for instance, that CCMS would have a duty to promote integrated education?
Mm-hmm. Yeah, go.
Yes,
for
well, it has a specific business plan target to support the department in taking forward its statutory duty.
I'm just wondering, between to some extent, there's probably an issue around interpretation of this, that what. To be fair, on any of the bodies would be counted very much as a duty by the department. We'll ultimately probably be paid with a certain level of lesser extent at the arm's length bodies. Yes, go ahead, Chris.
I may be mistaken, but I think Justice Tracy found that power being active or dormant, that it also spread to arm's length bodies. I think that was
certainly our legal advice would be that any statutory duty on ourselves is also applicable to our arm's length bodies.
So just for my brain's going slow here. At the moment then, the Education Authority now has a duty to promote, encourage and facilitate, but the department only has a duty to encourage and facilitate.
A power.
No, it doesn't.
We don't have any duty in relation to shared education. This bill's proposing that we have a power.
Oh, here, we need to have a bit more discussion about this.
Okay, folks, any other comments? Well, then, there is at four, there's basically the amendment which would place a duty on the department to promote, encourage and facilitate shared education. I suppose then we need just to determine whether members want to press ahead with that as an amendment or not.
No, we don't.
Any? I would support, to be honest with you.
I would, yeah.
Would you want, sorry, would you put it to a formal vote? Those in favour of Amendment 4?
1, 2, 3.
And
three.
Against?
1, 2, 3.
Right, move on then to Amendment 5. Now, again, sort of by way of reference, we'd again sought legal advice in relation. We got a number of bodies, most of our background here. There was a number of bodies which suggested that they should be on or want to be on the, in some shape or form, the face of the legislation. I think, to be fair, there was a point raised, particularly by the department, which is where it's probably well, which I think we've checked and got some level of confirmation from a legal point of view, that whereas you could make direct reference, the General Teaching Council is a creature statute,
yes.
There wasn't any particular problem with that, that you couldn't make direct reference to the other bodies, so therefore there's a formula which has been suggested, I think, by the Bill's office. That sort of things. Do you want to comment just to...
Yeah, just in terms of, obviously, the amendment has been suggested makes reference to sectoral bodies and then provides a suggested definition of sectoral bodies. From the department's perspective, I don't think we feel that's an adequate description, you know, an adequate legal description. Sector isn't recognised in law, and there's a whole variety of organisations that represent the interests of different schools, and it does open the door to a wide range of bodies therefore being listed, and giving them a power that was really designed for the department and its arm's length bodies.
As regards you said about recognition, but the wording which has been used by the Bill's office in terms of sectoral body on limb 3 is taken word for word from the department's own legislation.
Yep,
it says in section 73 of the Education Bill, sectoral body, in inverted commas, means, and then quotes exactly the word for that.
Sorry, I wasn't explicit. I'm actually meaning in terms of the grants paid under, because we would pay grants to a wide range of bodies under Article 64 of the...
Yeah, which is again identically with what is there in the legislation previously.
But then you'd be putting a par on those bodies. You know, for example, the IEF or the Irish Medium Trust Fund, we would make grants to them at various times under the 98 and the 89 order. So therefore, effectively, you'd be putting a par on them. Other Irish Medium bodies we might make grants to. They would then have a par to encourage and facilitate shared education. We would be placing that par on them.
Sorry, with respect on it, it's conjunctive in terms of the way this is, it talks about bodies which are recognised by the department and to which grants are done, so you'd have to effectively do a two-tiered test on it. The other thing as well is, if even on the basis that you're providing a power for somebody, it's not providing them with any obligation or duty, as you've indicated yourself on that side of it. And I mean, there was a strong concern raised by, I think, by NICE, by the, it was actually the transfers, but more or less on behalf of the controlled sectoral body, what were they? CC?
SSD.
Yeah, exactly. On that sort of thing.
It might be worth explaining that there are a number of other bodies that what we have mentioned within the bill are most of the statutory bodies. The other bodies are non-statutory limited companies in the most part.
Yes.
And as a general principle of law, a statutory body only has powers conferred on it by statute. A company, on the other hand, generally has very wide powers, which are set out in its constitution or its articles of association. Most of the sectoral bodies will already have a fairly wide general powers in their constitutions to act in relation to their respective sectors. However, if for some reason they didn't have, then it would be a matter of those bodies amending their constitutions.
I understand that, but if essentially the argument is therefore that they have a fairly wide power, so they could probably do this anyway on that regard, I could understand. I think the argument would be stronger, to be honest, if essentially towards those bodies we're imposing a duty on them. But I think to offer...
The legal advice is that it is inappropriate to, for all of those reasons, inappropriate to confer statutory powers on non-statutory bodies.
Yeah, but you already have referenced it. I mean, you will have a range of powers that are there anyway. But okay, yeah, members, any thoughts or?
Sandra? Sorry, could I just go through that again? So if we're putting a power, if we're giving a power to the department, then there'll be a power or duty. I know we're talking about relation, but that puts the same duty on the statutory bodies. Is that what we're saying?
Yes, but these are non-statutory bodies we're referring to.
Yeah, no, we are. But I'm just clarifying that that's already the case.
That's correct. If the duty extends to our arm's length bodies, if you amend the bill to give us a duty, you're effectively applying it to our arm's length bodies as well.
Okay, so we're talking about the ones that are not.
Yeah, the non-statutory and to get a power.
That's okay, just clarifying that, sorry.
Okay. I'm sorry? Yeah, and what about non-statutory arm's length bodies?
Yeah, they are our NDPBs, and therefore we would apply the statutory duty in the same way.
It kind of seems strange to me that you're basically saying if there's an amendment, which for instance goes through, which is basically duty on this, this will then place a duty on all arm's length bodies, irrespective of whether they're statutory or not, but you're then objecting to the same bodies having a power?
I don't think it's a matter of on the non-statutory, if it would apply to the statutory bodies, I think.
And hence that's why I asked specifically about the non-statutory bodies.
Yeah, I mean, again, the advice is that there is already provision for non-statutory bodies to build that in, and that that is the appropriate way to go rather than actually...
maybe I'm a little bit confused. I kind of find it a little bit odd that what we're saying is there's already provision to build it in, and therefore it's not appropriate that the power is given in that regard. That seems to my mind to be a bit of a contradiction in that.
Well, it wouldn't be giving them a power. What it would be doing would be altering their constitution to include that as part of their constitution, which is different from giving, you know, from a statutory power.
I think there's a difference between something that we would apply to our arms. I appreciate the question you're asking, but the difference between giving them an explicit power in legislation, which this bill would propose to do, and the department's application of its statutory duty via its arm's length bodies are two different concepts. In this amendment, you're actually proposing to give explicit statutory powers to non-statutory bodies.
I think, to be honest, there are a wide range of sectors within Northern Ireland in relation to education. And the way things have developed, there's some are statutory and some are non-statutory in their nature. Personally speaking, because they provide education and indeed support education to different sectors within, I would prefer to see a situation in which as much as possible that the distinctions between the two in terms of powers are as little as possible. And consequently, if we were to draw very much a distinction between here is one body in that particular field that has been given a power, and another is going to have to be tackled a completely different way. I'm not sure how appropriate that is. Kick this round. Does any other members have any comments? Trevor?
If it just said, instead of saying any sectoral body not listed above, if it said any body not listed above, leave out next line, just to say any body not listed above which is recognised by the department as representing the interests and to which grants are paid. How would that be?
That would expand it even more.
That would expand it
even more organisations.
Even wider range
more
groups.
I thought it was getting rid of the question of sectoral bodies, that's all. You know.
I think the reason why sectoral bodies, because it's a direct lift from the legislation previously on that sort of thing. Okay, look, members.
Make a point, Chair, in relation, because one of the other points that you have on this particular clause is about the General Teaching Council. Although the General Teaching Council is a statutory body, the existing legislation, the 1989 Education Order, provides for them to give advice to the department and employing authorities, and that includes training, career development, performance management of teachers and standards of teachers. Now, we believe that that is sufficient for their role in contributing towards shared education. However, that same order specifically requires consultation with DTCMI and other bodies and persons as appropriate prior to conferring or imposing any additional functions. So therefore, we can't do that without a consultation. So that would potentially delay the bill to an extent that we wouldn't be able to complete it in the current mandate.
Sorry, just say that last wee bit again.
The order specifically says that it requires consultation with DTCNI and other bodies and persons as appropriate prior to conferring or imposing any additional functions. In other words, we can't give them additional functions without first having a full consultation around.
I suppose there's two things in relation to that. I mean, I don't think anybody's particularly, to be fair, I think those DTC was mentioned by organisations. I don't think there's a particular pressure DTC to be there. So from that point of view, I'm relatively relaxed on whether it's there or not. I suppose the only issue in relation to that, I appreciate that therefore there couldn't be a power conferred ahead of that. I suppose the only issue on that is that if there was a strong desire to have GTC on that, all you need to do actually is different. You would have that as part of the commencement provisions. So you actually wouldn't enact that bit until that had happened. But by the same token, not detecting anybody particularly down a ditch over the GTC on that.
We feel there's a really sufficient provision there for them to do what we would need them to
members,
do.
Members, in terms of that amendment, if we take out reference to GTC on that bit, in relation to that though, members, in terms of Amendment 5, what are members and members supportive of that or opposed? Again, do we have a view? I mean, there was a number of folk that lobbied us on this, and that I think was a reasonable enough point. I thought I'd be supportive of 5. Is anybody to the contrary in terms of the amendment?
I don't have a view, Gerald. Right?
Okay. Well, take that then. Members agreed then. Overall, I appreciate that some people are, well, it's don't have a view type of thing, but is there anybody opposed to it in terms of that? Okay, so with that change of the GTC out, Amendment 6, I should point out now, moving on to. Right, just on that basis, are members then agreed with. I suppose, did we actually put clause 1? Okay, maybe just go back a little bit here on those bits then. We've suggested, I think, on. As it turned out, we didn't make any amendments to clause 1. We didn't propose any amendments to clause 1, did we?
We did, yes.
Oh, sorry.
Which was around the or none.
We did. So we've effectively suggested potential amendments to clause 1 and 2 in that regard. On that basis, and I appreciate on that bit, are members content with clauses, with each of them in clause 1 as amended potentially? So we're not going to be opposing clause 1, and similarly on clause 2. Notwithstanding the concerns we raised about particular elements. Sorry, apologies for that. Right, our Amendment 6 then, which I think is the final committee amendment, which is a sort of a review clause. Now, we took on board what's been said in terms of the timescale, because I think the reference in terms of a review and report mechanism that it could be tied in with ETI. We don't want to create any additional administrative burdens. I should also point out there's maybe, in terms of the draft you have in front of you, I think the committee had looked, now it's debating back and forth a little bit the exact wording of one of the subsections, but the final subsection 3, which is the attitudes bit, I think they get slightly tweaked wording of that, of attitudes of participating children towards persons from backgrounds other than their own, full stop. I know there was issues raised about what counts as relevant Section 75 groups. The bit, I think, where there's still a little bit of debate as to precisely what wording, and members may want to raise it with you, is the subsection 2 about good relations, whether it's between participating children or between participating children in school communities, or there's variations of it. Just in terms of generally, before we open up to members to probe, on that sort of new clause, you have any sort of comments?
Yeah, I mean, if I could just comment on the attitudinal improvement. I mean, attitudinal improvement is notoriously difficult to measure, and it does take time to achieve. And it's also influenced by a range of factors, family, peers, community. It's not solely within the remit of schools. In the report to the department, the Ministerial Advisory Group recognised that shared education can lead to improvements in attitude of young people, but they did stop short of actually recommending that that was included within the definition. And the reason that they did that was that they found evidence of engagement in shared education activities for those living in areas where there's low positive contact between communities may result in negative attitudes in the short term.
Yes.
Going forward. So
I should point out, in terms of the review and any reporting on this, we're not seeking to change the definition in that regard, simply that in any report those things are reflected upon in terms of
I think the point that the department made the last time was that there's really significant reporting requirements in terms of shared education already in place at both system and individual project level. At the in the Delivering Social Change project, you know, there's reporting mechanisms for that. There's robust business case, post-project evaluation. Each project will have targets and measures in the ETI. This just adds another reporting burden on the department. There's also other mechanisms.
With respect, our view on this was that this could be incorporated as part of the ETI report.
But then the ETI report isn't officially, it's obviously presented to the committee. It's not laid before the assembly as such, and it would be incorporated in the ETI report in any case. This is very explicit, but, you know.
Yeah, I appreciate that, but Suzanne, you've got to realise in relation to this, from the point of view of, the committee had a number of options. It could have looked at a change to the definition, because there's a range of some of these issues. For instance, I think there's significance that education attainment, the broader community cohesion bits, are regarded as being important. Like, we could have sought to change the definition. We felt that would be inappropriate and muddy the waters. We could have put in a purposes clause, but that could have run us into risks of a question then of interpretation. If you have a purposes clause and you have a definitions clause, I think the feeling on it was that a report happening once every 2 years was probably the minimum to try and satisfy some of these aspects in that regard on it. So, you know, we try to make it as compatible with the ETI as we can, just
I don't think we're arguing, because I think the fact that what we're actually saying is that there's sufficient provision already there without the need to specifically refer to it in the bill.
Okay,
that's the point. That's
appreciate the point. I wouldn't necessarily agree with that, but can we, I suppose, tease out just one area before we talk about the generality? There's been this issue, and I don't know whether Sean or others wants to raise this, the issue about the good relations bit and what the appropriate, if there was a clause of this nature going in, what the appropriate sort of test should be there. And again, I'll open up to members whether you want to quiz the department on that. John, do you want to?
Just particularly on that, the subsection 2, good relations between participating schools, between children's schools, what's your thoughts on that?
I mean, this is, in some respects, the good relations aspect. I mean, obviously it covers all the areas as the department has to address good relations. But the policy that mostly we deal with that would be the community relations, equality and diversity policy, opposed to the shared education policy.
Yep.
One of the difficulties will be, as it's currently worded, because we are looking at the impact of shared education on these, for example, education attainment, good relations and the attitudes. The difficulty is that there are, particularly in relation to educational attainment and also good relations, there are a number of other policies within the department that would impact on that. So trying to disaggregate the specific impact of shared education could be challenging, because there will be a number of factors. You know, we will measure how attitudes change, but that could be a result of a number of factors.
We had quite a bit of discussion about should it just be good community relations, or should it be good relationship between participating children and schools. What were your thoughts there? Just you have used the phrase good community relations on a number of occasions there. And my view would be it's probably a better phrase than saying good relations between participating schools and children.
Well, I'm assuming that obviously this was drafted by the Bill Office for you, so I'm assuming that what they have done is used good relations as is referred to in the Section 75 legislation.
I think the issue just in terms of that, and to be fair, I think the Bill's Office I put sort of a question mark over what way they word this on it. I think they're clear on the reference to good relations. It's whether it's simply good relations, whether it's good relations within the community, whether it's good relations between participating children, school community. It's how that's qualified or not. And I think we're just seeking your views as to what would create difficulties or not, what would be appropriate in terms of that, if you were.
I think limiting it to the children and young people participating is obviously an easier measure than talking about wider communities or groups, which obviously, you know, it's how you measure that, and that might present us some more difficulties. So for me, if we were being pushed on, I think we would prefer it to be limited to the pupil population.
And I suppose, Suzanne, the other issue that came from that, I think there's the issue about the wider community bit, and there's the issue of the children. What about any reference, one of the possibilities, reference to children and school communities? Or is that...
Again, well, school community we would take as the whole broad family of the school, the parents, the governors, you know, the local community, which is said. So it is quite a vague term as well in terms of school communities. So
your preference, if there was something in there, would be between...
Would be limited to the pupils, yeah.
Okay. Chris was next then.
You made reference there to a policy. Was it a good community? Sorry, I didn't get the full title.
Community Relations, Equality and Diversity Policy.
Is that with it overall?
That's the CRED policy.
But with regards to education, is there an overlap there? Does that come in anywhere within the department? You just have to, obviously, overall.
We have a specific CRED policy for education.
Yeah. Can we make reference to that, perhaps, in this? Obviously, because that takes in the wider community, doesn't it?
We would be reluctant to have any specific policies referenced in the legislation, because obviously policy titles and policy change over time, and it just could render what's put in the legislation a bit defunct if we started to reference it.
Is that measured within the department, is it?
It is measured by the department.
And is that the wider community relations, is it?
We measure the attitudes of children and young people particularly, the Life and Time survey will also measure the impact beyond that.
I think the point Andrew was making was that, in a sense, there's a lot of cross-culling. There's a lot of policies that obviously contribute to improvements in good relations. Yeah. It's not just shared education. There's also a whole raft of policies designed to improve educational attainment, in particular across our system, and at times isolating the particular impact. You know, for example, if you had a school that was in the formal intervention process and receiving intense support to improve standards and attainment, it might be quite difficult to isolate the impact of that support, perhaps support, you know, we had the Literacy and Numeracy Signature Project. There's a whole raft of initiatives that go into schools, and I think the point he was making was it's just that isolation of the particular impact of shared education, particularly in the short term, you know, may present some difficulties.
I think though it's important, and this has been actually said publicly, I think, with regards to the statistics that's coming out, that we need to be able to know which initiatives are having what effect, and if we're going to put resources in certain places. So we would like to be able to know to what extent shared education is improving. Great overall, if we can say overall, is that community relations are improving, but we need to know what's working, what's not. So,
yeah. And the qualitative stuff, I think, does give us that in terms of the qualitative analysis that the ETI do. But, you know, it's not always easy to isolate.
I think any of these monitoring things, I mean, unless you're talking about something that's very statistical in its nature, is always going to be slightly an exact science. Probably more getting a trend of things or improvement on that sort of things.
So the department currently assess pupils with relation to good community relations?
Well, we have the community, the CRED policy has a range of measures that we use to measure the impact of that policy, and one of the ways we do that is we commission a module every other year within the Young Life and Times, which gives us attitudinal change of young people, obviously a sample, but it is a representative sample, and that's how we do that.
Trevor?
Well, I think you've more or less answered it, actually. You can, I'm sure there's plenty of measures out there already, Life and Times, CRED and all the rest of it, measure any improvement in community relations, but how you would break that down to even general education policy and break it down further into the effect of this, it actually has been going on for many years. This is not a not a new thing, it's just been finally formalised. So it's not a question. I think we perhaps need something in here, and given the amount of emphasis and money that's going to be thrown at this over the next number of years, that we can clearly identify what the benefits are of this particular programme. If we can't do that, it'll wither, you know.
Yeah, well, I suppose we're not arguing that we're not doing that. What we're saying is that there's, I suppose the issue for the department is there's existing provision there to do that. That's the point. And
they believe
does the existing provision in any way try to measure the effect of what's already going on? in terms of sharing between schools?
Yeah, I mean, the commitment, and there's a commitment within the sharing works policy that obviously the Chief Inspector's report will on the biennial basis specifically refer to shared education. But then we also have reporting mechanisms in terms of the Programme for Government Commitment on Shared Education, and also mechanisms in terms of the Together Building a United Community commitments towards shared education. So as about our only point, we're not arguing that this shouldn't be reported on. Our only point is that there are already a number of mechanisms there, and that essentially we don't, you know, it's not necessary to include within within the bill.
Does the present arrangements in any way better measure the beneficial societal or community effect of integrated education?
Well, individual projects have measures. So if there was an individual project in terms of integrated education, obviously it would set measures. But at a system level, it's not something we would measure. Just.
And the range of measures we put in for this are related to shared education, which, as Suzanne has explained, integrated education is in legislative terms different. There are benefits for integrated schools participating in this programme, and for other schools of integrated schools participating in this programme, which is what we would want to see.
At the moment, you wouldn't attempt to measure the beneficial effects of children being educated together in integrated schools?
NICE would do quite a bit of work around that, and obviously we fund NICE, and NICE would do quite a bit of work around the positive impact in terms of reconciliation outcomes for children and people.
I think that would be nuts.
Yeah, in some way, it's outside the scope of shared education, this piece, because it's specifically integrated education.
Did you want to add a question?
Suzanne, and I may be picking up wrong, but I seem to be picking up that you're saying the bill doesn't have to be explicit because it's underpinned by the Share and Works policy.
Yeah.
That policy could change. Where would that leave this particular bill? Surely it's better to have strong monitoring and reporting specific to this bill.
It's not just underpinned by the Share and Works. What I'm trying to say is that all the projects and programmes have very specific reporting mechanisms built into them. The signature project is reported on at a system level. The OFM, DFM, it's reported on at a departmental system-wide level. It's individual projects have their own targets and measures. What we're saying is there's a whole raft of reporting out there. It's not just based on Share and Works. Share and Works provides a framework for that, but individual projects have those measures. We don't feel it's necessary to also reference this in the bill. What we're also saying is that in terms of the measures that are devised for shared education, because of the difficulty in disaggregating that we've talked about, they're very carefully devised and put in place so that we can try to begin that work of disaggregating. We just don't think it's particularly helpful to add another reporting mechanism with quite very broad
parameters. I think given the magnitude of the shared education, I think there's got to be some level of reporting mechanism. I think we tried to make it come. Folks, I want to bring this to conclusion. So I want to, I suppose, first of all, by way of just what we have on paper, there's possibly two areas which we need to clarify from ourselves, first of all. Really in relation to point E, first point is, it's been suggested by the department that it's good relations between participating children is the best way of monitoring that. Are members content with that? I mean, OCR can live with that element, or what way? Okay. Take silence. Exactly the essence of it. The second bit then, just to clarify, we previously talked about then, on point three, putting a full stop after only removing social again. Members happy enough with that as a wording?
Yeah. Okay. That's a full stop after their own.
Yes,
yeah.
But also removing the word social, so it's backgrounds from backgrounds other than their own. In terms of then the Amendment 6, are members content to agree Amendment 6?
Okay.
Right, move on then to, I think probably the last issue probably be directly by way of amendment, is the department then has its own proposal then for a new clause, provisionally, I suppose you might call it 2B, in relation to the forming a company in order to look after the ownership of school buildings and the shared campus and that sort of things.
So, sorry, Chairperson, this is the back page of tabled items, the very back page.
Okay. Again, I don't think there's been any particular controversy on this, but do you want to, is there anything else you want to add, just?
Yeah, just as mentioned previously in our last appearance, this clause is to provide the Department and the Education Authority with specific power to establish, to form and participate in a company to facilitate the governance and ownership of shared campus schools. It's specifically for shared education projects.
Okay, is there any final clarification anybody wants on that? Members content to approve the Department's amendment on that?
Yep.
Okay, agreed. Then, fair members, agreed, yes, what's it? Are there any dissenting voices on that?
Not dissenting, just I'm going to just say it. I don't know, I'm not dissenting.
Okay, I'm probably fighting through the other couple of items in relation to this. Clause 3, page 79. No suggested amendments to this. I don't know if the department wants to look at any extra controversy in clause 3. Has anybody said anything wishes to add, or is the committee content with clause 3? Agree? Great. Okay. Clause 4 is the short title and commencement of the Act. Again, there's been no amendments that have been sought in relation to clause 4. Again, are members content with clause 4?
Mm-hmm.
Great. Okay. Then, notwithstanding, obviously, the right of any member can put forward or any party can put forward their own amendments at any stage to the consideration stage. Is there anybody else, anything anybody wants to put forward as a committee amendment at this point? Or?
Is the, in the short title, but is the date, 2015, the date that it was put forward in the first place or the date it received rather than?
I suspect, Chairperson, the member's right, because we've had this before. The department will probably put forward a technical amendment at consideration stage to make it 2016.
We've created that as well. What we've been told is that the Bill Office will make that change.
Okay. I think it probably initially reflects whatever date is put forward, but then it's actually then whenever, as you say, whenever it gets Royal Assent, it's what actually appears on the face of the bill.
It does better than the ace of the bill, would be quite.
Yeah. it's like a clock in a garage, it's just going right in that regard. Right, the long title of the bill is A Bill to Make Provision in Relation to Shared Education. Is the committee content with the long title of the Shared Education Bill?
Yep.
Okay, great. Members, that concludes the formal clause by clause scrutiny of the bill. I'd like to thank the officials for their help. And in terms of our final sign-off by way of the committee report, we'll be on the 6th of January, so everything is meeting timetables. If you want to sneak a mince pie on your way out, we even have provided a bit of cream there in that regard. Okay, thank you.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Happy Christmas.
Okay, folks, the rest should be fairly quick. Correspondence, page 86-87, we have 9 items of correspondence. One item just to highlight is at 6.5, there's correspondence from the West Belfast Partnership Board, which is requesting an opportunity to brief the Committee on Educational Attainment. Again, if we can try and maybe get a briefing maybe in February or March, if members are content with that.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
That side of things. I don't have any other items to raise from the correspondence. I suppose, first of all, are members happy to deal with the correspondence as per the cover sheet? Agreed. Are there any other items of correspondence that any members wish to raise? Okay. If not, we'll move on to the next item, which is the draft work programme. Committee will be expecting to agree, obviously, our shared, as we've indicated, our report on the 6th of January, and then the committee says it's due to conclude on the 12th of January. Department will provide a briefing on the 6th of January in relation to the 2016-17 budget, and there will also be a briefing from the Assembly Public Finance and Scrutiny Unit on the budget to date. We may, as I think probably those sessions are likely to be quite full, there's an Erasmus Plus informal briefing, maybe if we can reschedule it for Tuesday the 19th of January at lunchtime, and a working lunch will be provided. Our members are content. Members happy to endorse the board work programme?
Yep.
Okay. AOB? Have done after this, you may wish to, members and staff, a happy Christmas and a prosperous new year. So it depends. If you raise any other business, that bit might get cut, but any other business? Okay, if not, then wish everybody a Merry Christmas and Happy New Year, and thank you all for your forbearance, given the fact we were sitting purely on quorum throughout. We managed to get through everything. The next meeting we'll be back to our usual haunt in the Senate chamber on Wednesday the 6th of January at 10 a.m. Also, I think then on the 7th is the Young Scientist.
Going to Dublin, yeah.
Okay. So I would put then the question that the committee does now adjourn. The committee is adjourned. This is the North